This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, guys. We'll start our the basic understanding because I mentioned in my demo session itself. Like before going into the LoadRunner tool, first we'll try to construct the fundamental knowledge on the performance testing world. Then only if you are going into the tool, the terms and terminologies that we are using will be very familiar, so that you can understand in what way we are getting these things. Okay, so Rakesh, Ujwala and Srivalli, I encourage you guys, like whenever I'm explaining about some topic, if you are feeling that you need something to be clarified, please stop me at any point of time and then you can ask your queries, because I want you to be very thorough in these concepts, because all these concepts, why it is very important, say when you are doing a performance testing, that time you are providing a report to the stakeholder and the stakeholder is asking some question to you related to the report or related to some performance testing concepts, you should be thorough in answering to those questions. Okay, so you should be in a position to answer to those people. If you are not answering to the question what they were asking, they will feel like this guy doesn't know anything, so we can reject this report, reject his performance testing report. So don't we don't want to be in that situation, right? So it is good that if you learn all these fundamentals clearly, we will be in a position to answer to all those questions. Okay, why I'm saying, example, I worked in a project where there are 100 developers and then one performance tester. 100 developers, one performance tester. When I provide a report, you think it of how many people will come and ask you clarifications, right? So 100 is to 1 means you should be very strong in your domain knowledge, your fundamental knowledge. Then only we can answer to those people question. Okay. So without wasting further time, like I'll move on to the topic, architecture basics. Okay, architecture basics. First of all, what is architecture? Okay, what is architecture? You say an example, your application is deployed. Your application is deployed. Say you are working in Google. Think it like this, you are working in Google. Your application is deployed. Means first you should know the architecture of how the application is deployed. Say an example, there is a web server, there is an app server, and there is a DB server. All these are architecture, right? How it is connected, how these are interconnected. Say this data is going from here and this data is going from here, and then there is a data coming from here to here, and there is a data coming from here to here, like that. There is a connection, there is a flow, there is a diagram which is representing the connection between one to the other. There is, somebody will say, there is a security layer sitting between every server. There is a security layer. You can think like this. All these are called as architecture. All these are called as architecture, which is representing how the request is traveling from one place to the other, how it is really represented. It is, I think those who are from the engineering background or some science related background, you know, they will know the topology and all. Topology means star topology, ring topology, like that. There are some topological way where they are representing how the servers are structured, how the servers are structured. There are people will represent like this. I'll show like this. There are people will represent like this. You have a web server connected, you have an app server connected, you have a DB server connected, and it is connected to the browser. Like that, people will represent. So there are, this is all called as architecture. Architecture is nothing but how servers are connected, how the machines are interconnected, how your system is designed. So there is a document, we will collect it as part of the performance testing. We will collect the documents called NFR, which is nothing but non-functional requirement document. Okay, non-functional requirement document. Okay, non-functional requirement document means what is that? You are getting the requirement which are required to do a performance testing. which are required to do a performance testing. So in that document, actually we will get all these details. In that document, we'll try to get like say in your organization, if they are not using non-functional requirement document, it may collected in the test strategy or a test plan. Here also people will try to collect this. It is not that this guy told NFR in that no, it has to be collected in NFR, or if it is in inside the test strategy or test plan also fine. In that way also you can collect that architecture related diagram, related information. Why I am saying, if you are not aware of the architecture, how will you decide your protocol? Say if it is a web application, if it is a SAP application, if it is a Oracle application, if it is a Siebel application, if it is a Citrix application, you should know that first, right? Technology stack and the architecture detail. Then only you can decide which protocol. Protocol is nothing but in LoadRunner, while recording, you should select a protocol and then you have to start recording, guys. Okay, that is the meaning. So in order to choose the protocol, you should know the technology stack as well. You should know the technology stack. So in order to know the technology stack, at least you should know the fundamentals like architecture diagram and all, right? That is the reason we are collecting the architecture diagram. Guys, anyone have any question? Please ask me, guys.
Suppose if anyone don't have knowledge in the technology stack, so how he will be able to decide which protocol to use? And like if he's just a layman and he's just starting in this field, so how we can proceed actually?
You should have an basic understanding how the application is invoked, how they are launching that application. If they are launching it in the web browser, most 90 to 95% it is HTTP HTML protocol. Okay, if they are launching it in the browser, okay, and then then in the corner scenarios you can say the other protocols like SAP or Siebel, those like that. But in my experience, this is the first time you are joining, right? This is the first class.
Yeah.
I have close to a decade experience in this, 11 years of experience in this performance world. Okay, out of my experience, 90% to 95% people will work in web protocol only, others web HTTP HTML protocol. Okay. What is that meaning? Every application in the world, most of them are working in browser. That is the reason. If I get a chance to interview some 6 years or 8 years experience people, you know, if I ask them which protocol you have experience, people will say web HTTP HTML. That's all. Actually, saying there are lots and lots of protocols are there. I will show you in the tool also. There are lots and lots of protocols are there, but most of the people will work in HTTP protocol only, because that is the need of the market. That is the need of the market. You, if you know HTTP HTML protocol, you can at least survive. That is the meaning. Able to understand, others?
Yes.
Yeah. So if I create a new script in LoadRunner, no, if I click new script, these are the protocol list, others. These are the protocol lists are available, but predominantly we will use web HTTP HTML protocol. Clear? Did I answer your question, others?
Yeah. Okay.
So architecture diagram is for that purpose only we are getting the architecture diagram. So what will happen, many a times we will not get the full architecture diagram detail and all, no walkthrough will be provided, but as per the procedure, if you are knowing the architecture diagram, it is a value add for you. That is the reason, get the knowledge of the architecture diagram or the technology stack detail, all those information, it is all a value add for you. It is a value add. So that is about the architecture. And then importance of the architecture that I mentioned, because if you know the flow, right, say someone mentioned like this the architecture diagram, if the web server and the app server and the DB server are there like this, okay, and there is a connection like this, say like there is a connection like this, okay, and then there is a connection to a external system. Say they are mentioning there is an external system is available. To that, this app server is talking like this. If they are telling this information means, what is that meaning? There is an external server, there is an external third party machine where there is a connection like this. Representation is here means, then you will ask the question, right? If you know the architecture, you will ask the question to the stakeholder. I will monitor web server. Monitor will be happening here. Okay. I will monitor app server. Monitoring will be happening here. I will monitor the DB server. Monitoring will be happening here. But I will not monitor this place. Will not monitor this place. Because it is a third party, right? It is a third party. You do not have any control. Correct? You do not have any control. So you will not monitor. So once you know that architecture only, you can talk to the stakeholder and tell them what is your scope, what is out of scope. What is your scope? What is out of scope? So in order to do that, you should know the architecture understanding, right? Or the basic understanding of how the machines are connected, how these informations are traveling from one place to the other. You're able to get the point, right? So say, what is that third party? Somebody will ask me, you are simply saying it is a third party. What is a third party? Say an example, you are testing an application, retail application, where you want to do a payment. There is a payment gateway is there, right? Will you test the payment gateway? Will you test the payment gateway? It is not necessary. It is not necessary to test a payment gateway and all, right? But there are times there are customers are asking, but what they will do, they'll stop that environment, do a dummy data, and then they are doing. But predominantly, testing a gateway and all, it is not required because that is a third party. Some other is owning that. If you say payment gateway is slow, will those people fix for you? No. They will not fix it for you because your application developer only will help you to fix the code and all. Third party people cannot help you to fix the code and all, right? So in order to define your scope, here only I'm going to do the scripting. Here only I'm going to do the monitoring. In order to define the scope, you should require this architecture understanding. Clear, guys? Clear, guys? Adarsh,
yes,
Uswala. Okay, Rakesh?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, sir.
So this architecture is different for different protocols?
No, this architecture is different for a different application, accounts. Those who are working, you are working with the different accounts, right? They are developing an application. For them, it is different architecture altogether. Say an example, today I'm working with one project. That project is having an architecture. Tomorrow I'm moving to a different project. That project is having a different architecture. So the architecture is project to project, it varies. Give me 2 minutes, sir. I'm getting a call. Okay, yeah, thank you. This is what the importance of the architecture. And then the next one is understanding servers. Understanding servers is nothing but, as I mentioned earlier, you should know what are all the servers are there in your application. The application where you are going to work, right? There you should have an understanding that, sorry, say my application, what is web server? In my application, what is web server? Okay, what is web server? And then what is app server and what is DB server? Okay, what is DB server? Say in my application, what is web server is nothing but my web server is made of what? It is a Windows server or it is a Linux server or else leave that. Instead of Linux or Unix, you can say it is a IIS server or it is a Tomcat server. Like that, you should understand what is your web server. And then the same case for app server. What is your app server? And then what is your DB server? Say in this DB server, what will you say? It is a Oracle Oracle One or a SQL Server or MySQL or Postgres or Mongo. Like that, you should understand what is your server. Okay. So maybe for the benefit of you people, I will explain what is web server. Web server is nothing but your application is having a static components. Your application is having a static components. Those are stored in the web server. The resources. These resources are stored in the web server. What is that resources? When you are clicking a login button, it is launching a page, right? Username, password, and then you are clicking a login button. It is launching the page, right? In that page, there are images will be there. There are static contents will be there. PNG files, JPEG files, all these are there, right? Those files are stored into web server. Web server is predominantly a static component loading place. Okay. And then app server. App server is nothing but where my business logic is there. I am doing a functionality. Say if I click addition means addition should happen. If I click subtraction means subtraction should happen. If I click multiply means multiply. This is all a logic, right? A functionality. That functionality logic will be there in the app server. Business flow. Okay. Functional logic. Okay. The functional logic should be there in the app server. And then the data. The data required will be there in the, say an example, if I try to pull some information related to others, which means that others related information like other, others name, telephone number, city, country, all those are stored into the DB, right? The data. Those data are stored in DB. Okay, data related part. Now you are able to understand, guys, when you are triggering a request, there are static components, there are business logic, and they are data. All these are stored in respective servers. Able to understand, guys, what is this? Anyone have any question?
No, museum, yes.
Okay, so this is about the servers. Web server, app server, DB server. Web server will have a static contents, app server will have a business logic, DB server will have a data. Okay, that is what about this understanding of servers and web app server purpose. Okay, that is what this. And what is protocol? Protocol is nothing but I am speaking to you guys, which means that my voice is a protocol. There is a communication established between one entity to other entity. Okay, that is called protocol. In this case, my voice is a protocol between you and me. Okay, say an example, when the browser is triggering and then the data is going to the server, the HTTP is a protocol. HTTP request is a protocol. So what is that meaning? Between two entity, there is a connection established. There is a communication established. That communication establishment will be happening using this protocol. Able to understand, guys, what is protocol? What is protocol? You're able to understand, right? In my case, I'm speaking now, and then you guys are able to hear my voice. So my voice is a communication protocol here. Able to understand?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Uzwala. And then different types of protocol, and then understanding of HTTP protocol. As I showed you now, there are different protocols are there in LoadRunner, but predominantly we will use HTTP protocol. But for the benefit, I'm showing you what all the different protocols are there. So if you are working in .NET based application, you can use .NET protocol. Okay, you can use .NET protocol. And then if you are using a Citrix application, then you can use Citrix protocol. Okay, when you are using a Java related application, That time you can use either Java over HTTP, Java record replay, Java VUser. All these three protocol you can use when you are using for Java related application. When somebody is saying Internet of Things, IoT related things, that time you can use this MQTT protocol. And then if you are working with Oracle related things, that time you can use Oracle two tier, Oracle Web and Oracle NCA. And then if you are using SAP related things, SAP Web, SAP GUI. If you are working in Siebel, Siebel Web is there. And then web, as already I mentioned, if it is HTTP. And then if you are working with the web services, say like SOAP call, REST call, those things, you know, you can use this web services protocol. And then there is a thing called TrueClient protocol. See, this web protocol, no, this web protocol will not have a browser related metric. This web protocol will not have browser related metrics. In order to collect the browser related metric, you can use a TrueClient protocol. TrueClient protocol is available. TrueClient, which is nothing but you are going to get the browser related metric. These are the protocols which are available. Web HTTP HTML protocol, which is nothing but whichever the application is launched through, whichever the application is launched through browser, and then the browser is able to communicate through HTTP, hypertext transfer protocol. Okay, you can do this recording. Say I'll explain like this. You are opening a Chrome browser. You are opening a Chrome browser, and then I'm saying like flipkart.com. Just a moment. Flipkart.com. Okay, flipkart.com. Before giving enter, you know, I'm clicking F12. There is a developer tool is opening, right? You're able to see your developer tool screen. Able to see, guys?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
What did you click?
What is that?
What did you click?
F12.
Okay.
I'll type it here, maybe. F12. Okay. F12, if I press it in the keyboard, no? What is happening? It is opening a developer tool. Okay. So if I do something in the page now, say this is a page where I typed simultaneously, I want to show you both. Yeah. If I click this refresh button, no, or else enter button, what will happen in the screen? You are able to see some traffic is loading, right? Some traffic is loading. So this is what we are saying. When you are invoking something in the browser, if it is talking in HTTP HTML mode, you are getting this traffic, HTTP HTML mode. So this is one way you can understand your application is HTTP communicated application, and then you are able to understand, you are trying to capture that using the load runner tool itself. You're able to capture that using load runner tool itself. You're able to understand, right, what I'm saying? So HTTP HTML is nothing but you are invoking something into the browser, and that communication is happening using HTTP. Okay. Somebody newly joined, no? Is it Elsa? Elsa, you joined now, right?
Elsa? Yes, I'm in now.
Yeah. See, till now we are building a fundamental knowledge on the performance testing, Elsa. So what we are doing here, before straight away jump into the tool, I just want to have a fundamental understanding of performance testing. Then only you will know whatever I'm talking in the perspective of performance testing terms and terminologies. Say if I'm suddenly using a term called throughput, hits per second, like that, you know, people will get think like, I don't know, it's all Greek and Latin for me. So what I'm doing now, I'm constructing a basic knowledge in the performance testing, and then we'll move on to the load runner tool. Fine for you, right?
Yep, absolutely. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So what we are doing, we just saw what is that different types of protocol and understanding of HTTP protocol. And then different types of architecture. This is also very important. Different types of architecture is nothing but it is all case to case. I'll tell you. There are customers are very small scale customers. They are very small scale customers. Because of that, their application is very, very small. Their application will be used by some 20 people or 30 people application means. What they will do, they will deploy all the infrastructure in a single place. All the infrastructure. Say an example I will show like this. In a single machine, they will deploy their they'll deploy their web server, they'll deploy their app server, and then they'll deploy their DB server in a single machine. They'll deploy their web server, they'll deploy their app server, and then they'll deploy their DB server as well. Okay, that is what app server. And then the DB server in a single machine. This type of deployment is called one tier architecture, guys. One tier is nothing but in a single machine, they are installing all the things. They are installing all the things in a single machine. This is called as one tier or single tier, whichever you call it as. It is a one tier or single tier architecture. Okay. Okay, guys, this is called as one tier architecture. Able to understand what I'm saying? One tier architecture in a single machine, in one machine, one server, whatever you call it as, one machine or one server. One server. If you install everything into one machine, that is called as single tier or one tier architecture. Able to understand, guys?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Say you consider like this. You have two machine. Okay. Wherein you are installing web server alone in one machine. App and DB in another machine. Or else you have two machines. In that you are trying to install web and app in one machine and then DB alone in another machine, vice versa, which means that whenever you are combining these servers in two machine, that is called as two tier architecture. This type of infrastructure is called two tier architecture. Able to understand, right? What is two tier architecture? Guys, able to understand it, right? Two tier architecture is nothing but the web and app DB, how they are splitting in two machine. Able to understand it, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And then three tier architecture is nothing but there are three different machines. Machine one, machine two, and machine three. In one machine, they will deploy web server. In another machine, they will deploy app server. And another machine, they will deploy DB server. Okay. In this machine, they are saying like web server. In this machine, they are saying like app server. In this machine, they are saying like DB server. This is called as three-tier architecture. This is called as three-tier architecture. Able to understand what is three-tier architecture?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Say you have multiple web servers, multiple app servers, and multiple DB servers that are in clusters. Or else I'll represent like this. You have like this. This is web server. In that, lot of other web servers are connected. One web server and lot of web servers are connected. Okay. And then you have app server. You have app server, and in that lot of app servers are connected. You have app server, and then you have lot of app servers are connected. Okay, and you have a DB server, in that lot of DB servers are connected. Lot of DB servers are connected. Okay, this is called as multi-tier architecture or n-tier architecture. This is called as multi-tier or n-tier architecture. Okay, guys, till now, please tell me you are able to understand what is one-tier, what is two-tier, what is three-tier, what is multi-tier architecture?
Can you give any practical example for one tier, two tier, three tier architecture?
See, that is what I told you. Say an example. I developed one application for a college attendance or school attendance. I developed an application. Okay. What that principal or someone is saying, see, I don't want to spend a lot of money for procuring the servers, right? You install everything into a single machine itself. In that single machine, you can install the web app, DB, everything. Because anyways, I'm going to minimally use it, that application. Very minimally, I'm going to use that application. So I don't want to buy a lot of machine and all. You install that application in one machine itself. That time, what will you do? You will go and install the web app, DB, everything into a single machine. In a single machine, you will install everything. Okay. What will happen? That kind of a deployment is called one-tier architecture or single-tier architecture. In a single, you will install everything in a single desktop machine. One machine, you will install the web app, DB, everything. That is called one tier architecture. Able to understand others? What is that?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So sometimes what will happen? The same college, they are saying, I'm going to use this attendance application for some 10 departments or 20 department students. So for me, looks to be little higher volume. So what I am doing, I am giving you one more machine, one more desktop machine I am giving. In the first machine, you install the web server. In the second machine, you install the app server and DB server. They are telling you like that means that is called two-tier architecture. That is called two-tier architecture. You able to understand what is two-tier architecture, Adarsh?
You mean there will be two machines and in that we will be installing all the three servers, right?
Yeah. You will install in desktop one, you will install web server. Desktop two, you will install app and DB. Or else you in desktop one, you will install web and app. Desktop two, you will install DB. Whichever the way you can split it, but these three servers has to be splitted across two machine. That is called as two-tier architecture. Two tiers are there. Able to understand it, right? Okay, the same college principal is saying, I have one another college also. There are two college attendance. I'm going to maintain it. Can you put it like three machine? I'm giving you three desktop machine. You put all these three servers in the different machine. Three different machine. One machine web server, one machine app server, one machine DB server. That is called three-tier architecture. Able to understand? Able to understand others?
Yeah.
And then the same guy who is running another company or another organization, there also he wants to deploy the same attendance application. What he is thinking, this desktop is having only 4GB RAM only. That 4GB RAM cannot accumulate this much of a load. What he is thinking, why don't you have some nine machine he is giving to you, and he is saying in three machine you install web server, in three machine you install app server, and you three machine you install DB server. Nine machine, right? That is called as multi-tier architecture. You're able to understand, Nadesh?
Yeah. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, this is what the N-tier, multi-tier, all these things actually saying. Those who are going to attend any interview, they will ask this as an important question. Can you explain entire architecture? Can you explain entire architecture or a three-tier architecture? See, if you are going like a fresher, many a time you will not get this kind of a question. But if you are going like a little experienced guy, you will get this kind of a question. If you are going like experienced guy, you will get questions in architecture. What is entire architecture? What is three-tier architecture? Like that, and all, you will get questions. Clear, guys? That is the reason I'm spending a small time here, so that you will be thorough in this concept. Okay, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Rakesh, you are clear with this concept and all, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Rakesh. And Srivalli, you are also clear with these concepts. Srivalli? It's okay. She's mute. Okay. Ujwala, you are also clear, right? You are also clear with whatever we are checking.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So all these understanding should be there, guys, because since only knowing the tool, load runner tool, and what the metric is provided by the tool, that alone is not the performance testing. You should know whatever the metric it is coming from the load runner tool to understand it little clearly, then only you can convince the stakeholder. If you know 100% confident, then only you can talk to the stakeholders, right? So these concepts are all very, very important. Okay. So I'm moving on. Two-tier, three-tier, static component and dynamic component. See, static component, as I mentioned it earlier, CSS components or PNG, JPEG, there are image files are there, right? Those are called as static components. It will not change at all. Say I'll show it in the F12 itself. This F12 I opened for this Flipkart application, right? You can see the type. In the type column, there are PNG files are there. There are GIF files are there. Okay, there are text files are there. There are web app files are there. Like that, it is showing, right? If it is something, you can go into the right hand side. There are some places it is showing disk cache, like that, right? What is that meaning? Disk cache means it is coming from the browser cache itself. The data which are coming from the browser cache itself. So those are all called the static components. There are static components which can be cached, and those are called as it will not change at all. The static component will not change at all. It will always come like this only. Say an example, guys. In this page, in this Isha page, there is an image coming, right? Isha making IT easy. This image will not change at all, right? How many times if you are refreshing, it will only give that image. So that image is a static component, which will not change at all, That is called as static components. Any doubt in static component, guys? Any doubt in static component?
What did you say earlier when you say data coming from, where is it coming from? The disk cache.
Yeah. See, I will tell you like this. If I open the incognito window, okay, and then I'm using this, just a minute, I'll close all the browsers. I opened the incognito window and then I click F12. Okay. Say an example, I'm typing like Facebook.com. Okay. If I click enter, if I go to the F12, you can see all these components, right? All these components, like these all components are showing some size, some number. Okay, for now, it is showing some size and number, right? Size and number, you are able to see it is all showing some size and number. Say an example, what I am doing, I am refreshing this page. I'll clear this log, and then I'm going again. I'm refreshing this page. Now you can see it is all showing as cache, disk cache, memory cache, disk cache, memory cache. You're able to see that same component. Why it is showing like this?
Because it doesn't change.
Because this data is already there in the browser, it is taking the data and showing it to you. It is not going to the server. It is not requesting the server because the data are already available in the browser cache itself. It is taking the data from the browser cache and displaying to us. Okay. If I again open that in an incognito window, or if I clear the cache, and then if I open it again, that time it will request the server. Whenever it is requesting the server for the first time, it will take the data. And the next time and all, it will try to take it from the browser cache itself. Able to understand, Elisa?
Yes, I got it. Thank you.
Yeah.
What is the difference between disk cache and memory cache?
There are things it is taking from my ROM. There are things it is taking from my RAM. That is what the meaning. Something is it is stored in the disk and something is stored in the RAM and it is trying to take the data. That is what the meaning. ROM, which is nothing but my hard disk. RAM is nothing but my RAM where it is taking the data. See, I'll tell you. See, if I go to that, it will be a detailed topic. In a precise way, I'll tell you. There is a concept called swapping. There is a concept called memory swapping. Okay. The developer will write the logic in such a way which has to be stored in ROM, which has to be stored in RAM. Okay. There are things will store in temporary storage. There are things will store in the permanent storage, which is nothing but ROM. So based on that, the data will be stored there. And then when you are trying to retrieve it, it will try to retrieve from either from the ROM or from the RAM. Able to understand others?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, we have another 10 minutes. I'll start a topic. If it is beyond, we'll wrap up for sure. Okay, what is testing and functional and non-functional testing? I did not explain the dynamic content, right? Sorry. Static content is one which will never change. Okay, dynamic content is nothing but, say, I'll show you maybe. You observe this link, okay? You observe this link, this URL. You observe this link. I copy pasted into my Notepad++, and then I'm clicking some other link. You can see, you're able to see a difference in the URL, this URL and this URL. You're able to see a difference? Because the contents are changing, right? It is a dynamically changing values. If the contents are changing, the link also is changing. This is called dynamic contents. Say I'll tell you like this. Adarsh is logging into Flipkart by morning 9 o'clock. Okay. And then he is logging out. And then 12 o'clock he is logging again. Will the same session ID will be used? Whatever he opened in 9 o'clock session will the same session will be opened in 12 o'clock? No, right? There is a unique session ID will be created in 12 o'clock also. Those session ID are changing. For 9 o'clock, you will have one session ID, and 12 o'clock, you will have one session ID. These are called as dynamic contents. Able to understand, guys, what is dynamic, what is static? Static, which is nothing but it will never change, it will always be same. Dynamic content is nothing but which is something changing every time. There is a session ID which is changing, or there is a token which is changing. Those are called dynamic contents. Clear, others?
What is the difference between cache and cookie?
See, cache is browser concept, right? Cookie is nothing but some junk which is there. Cache is nothing but, you can say cache will be a logical data, cookie will be a junk data. In that way you understand it. Okay.
Yeah.
Cache is nothing but a logical data, cookie will be a junk data.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'll start what is testing, non-functional testing. With that, I'll close the session today. What is testing, functional testing or non-functional testing? Functional testing is nothing but you are checking the functionality. Say an example, username, password, click login, which is a functionality, right? Username, password, click login button should login into the application. It is a functionality. If you are checking that, that is called as functional testing. Non-functional testing, which is of different types, guys. Non-functional testing, which is of different types. One is usability, compatibility, security, performance,
interoperability.
No. That and all is different. Accessibility. Okay. This is these five. Okay, are non-functional testing. Okay, usability, compatibility, security, performance, accessibility. We are focusing on performance testing because we are working on the performance testing place. So non-functional testing predominantly focusing on this, and which will never focus on functionality. Never focus on functionality in the sense, yeah, it is required. Stable functional application only you can do performance testing. But performance testing, what it will do, checking the stability of the application under load. That is a meaning. Stability of the application under load. This is what performance testing. Stability of the application under load. You will under load is nothing but you are giving some user load. How that application is performing with respect to load, response time, like that you will measure it. You will measure it, load, response time. Maybe you can say hits per second, and also you will say throughput. All these ways you will measure the performance. So basic understanding, what is functional testing? Functional testing, you are going to check the functionality of the application. Non-functional testing, you will check the non-functional attributes like response time, load, hits, throughput, all those things. You are going to measure it in the non-functional things. Okay, actually our focus is towards performance. Okay, maybe in Monday's class I will try to explain you what are all the different types of, because you should know what is what, right? So in Monday's class, what will I do? I'll explain you what is usability, compatibility, security, and what is accessibility also, for your understanding, for your one-liner understanding. If someone is coming and asking you what is compatibility, then you should at least talk one line, right? So that is the reason I will explain on Monday. I'll explain what these testing types and all. Okay, guys. You have any question, guys, please ask me. I encourage people to ask multiple questions. If you are really have any question, definitely you can ask. Okay.
Thank you. Is the next session going to be on Monday, or
yeah.
I think it's going to be on Sunday for us, right?
Yeah, correct. Correct, Elsa. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, guys. Thanks for joining today's session, and have a nice day. Nice day, guys. Thank you.
Another question. Are you gonna send the recorded video for us just to revise?
Yeah. We'll share with you, everyone. Yeah, we will.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.